Good morning and welcome. We are so glad you're here with us this morning. We are blessed to be in the house of the Lord on such a beautiful Sunday morning. So glad to see so many faces out here in the congregation. And whether you're watching here online with us on Facebook or you're in the congregation in person, we are again blessed to have you here with us this morning. I have a list of announcements. This morning we have a lot going on in the church this week, and I want to make sure that everybody is in the loop as far as all that goes. Tonight at 6 p.m., from 6 to 7 p.m. is our monthly war room prayer time. This month, we will be focusing on families and loved ones for our hour of prayer from 6 to 7 tonight. So join us here in person in the sanctuary for our war room monthly prayer time. My wife has informed me that the Fredericktown Christian Preschool is already accepting applications for next school year. And from what I understand, particularly like the three-year-old class is filling up really quickly, which is like unheard of this early in the season, but we are again blessed by that. So if you know somebody that is interested in enrolling in preschool here, tell them to get a hold of my wife fairly quickly or the preschool office as well, and we can get information to you as far as enrollment. I was also told that on, where'd the date go? On the 25th of the month, we are going to be having a loose change offering for the preschool this year in lieu of their normal ham loaf fundraiser that they do. COVID protocols and such make it very difficult to accomplish that, so they are going to be doing a loose change offering on the 25th. The ASAP Sunday School class is still hosting our annual golf outing, and Janice has told me that she's now up to four teams. She's going to be playing each hole four times, and everybody wants her on her team for some reason. I don't understand why, but that will be coming up on June 6th. If you're interested in signing up for a team, maybe you can ask Janice. She can add another one. Get a hold of the office, and we'll get you signed up for a team for the golf outing. All that money, the proceeds from that, go towards our building fund to help pay for this new awesome addition we have out here. High school senior parents, we need 6 to 8 baby sports events, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, photos from your son or your daughter's life that we can put together for a presentation, which will be May 2nd here. We need those pictures turned in either to the office or to Brian and Julie by the 23rd of this month so that they have time to put them together into that presentation for us for that next Sunday, the 2nd of May. I did receive an email late this week. Diana Partington is asking for prayers for Bob. He is going in for surgery tomorrow. The surgery is for an obstructed bile duct, but they're also going to be doing a biopsy of the liver and pancreas. Again, his surgery is tomorrow, so we want to keep Bob in our prayers. Write him on your prayer list. Keep it there at your prayer desk, wherever you spend time with the Lord, and make sure to lift him up. Now, I did save the most important announcement for the very last here. It's a life-changing announcement. It's a earth shaker. Today is Patty Geppinger's birthday. It is. She's turning 29 today. It's what, like your 10th or 11th, 29th birthday, something like that.
Stop it, Ross.
But it is Patty's birthday today, so make sure that you wish Patty a happy birthday this morning. If you see her out in the hallways after the service, I'd tell you to give her a hug, but that's between you and her. So if nothing else, give her an elbow bump and tell her happy birthday.
I'm fully vaccinated. Just saying.
All is well. So since it is Patty's birthday, I'm going to ask her to open us in a word of prayer this morning before we move into our time of worship.
Would you stand, please, and let's raise our hands. Thank you, Father. You are good, good God. You are gracious and so deserving of all of our praise. Father, we just invite you into our service this morning. Let us just turn around and give all worship right back to you. You are holy, and we love you. So let's have a great day today, and let's just praise you like no other. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Lord, I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. Without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. You're my one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, how I need you. With comes my way, and when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. When I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. You're my hope and stay. Oh,
Every day. We celebrated Easter just last week. It seems like forever ago already, but it's only been a week. And we celebrate the fact that Jesus was crucified and resurrected, more importantly. And we know that in reality, that was our place on the cross. That was our place in the tomb. And without Christ, we wouldn't have been able to come out of that death, out of that darkness and back into the light. So it's merely by His grace and His grace alone that we are saved.
Grace, what have You done? You murdered for me on that cross, accused in absence of wrong, my sin washed away in Your blood. Much to make sense of it all. I know that Your love breaks my fall. The scandal of grace, You died in my place.
So my soul will live.
Oh, to be like You. I give all I have just to know. Your strength is enough. The scandal of grace, You died in my place.
So my soul
will live. Oh, to be like You. I give all I have just to know You. Jesus, there's no one beside You. Forever. But it won't prosper. When the darkness falls, it won't prevail. 'Cause the God I serve knows only how to triumph. And my God will never fail.
You believe that this morning?
That my God will never fail. And I'm gonna see it. Yes, I know how this story ends. Yes, you turn it for good. But you take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. Yes, you turn it for good. Whoa, you take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. Yes, you turn it for good. Turn it for good. I'm gonna see your victory. I'm gonna see your victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see your victory. I'm gonna see your victory.
Raise your hand if you're claiming victory this morning.
For the battle belongs to you, Lord.
Let's do that again.
I'm gonna see your victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord.
Come on, do you believe that today?
Well, I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. For the battle belongs to you, Lord,
not to us.
For the battle belongs to you, Lord.
We hold on to that truth this morning, that it is not by our struggles, by our might, by our flesh and blood that we can accomplish these victories, Lord, that it is only through the sacrifice of your Son on the cross and his resurrection, Lord, through the Spirit that dwells in each of us this morning, that we can accomplish that victory, that we can win those battles that are placed before us, Lord, that we can triumph over temptation, that we can see the light at the end of the tunnel because we know that you are the light and you are the truth. This morning, won't you open our hearts to receive and to understand your word this morning as we cling to every word that is yours. We ask in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. You guys can have a seat.
Good morning, everyone. That was so lame. Good morning, everyone. Anybody here? Yeah, good. Okay. So this month in kids ministry, we're going to reconnect. So we're going to play a little opposites game. What is the opposite of sweet? Sour or salty? Yep. What is the opposite of left? Right. And what is the opposite of fast?
Slow.
Who said breakfast? Half point. Okay, so those were easy, but how about one more? What is the opposite of anger? This is a little different, isn't it? Peace? That's right. Who said that? Reagan? Yep, Reagan's been down in a small group. She knows what we're talking about this month. Peace. Think about that for a second. Do you want your kids to grow up angry? I'm talking out of control, self-centered, short-fused, I'm going to hurt somebody if I don't get my way kind of anger? Of course not. Of course not. After all, you don't have to look very far to see the kind of damage that kind of anger can do. It's the reason fights break out on basketball courts. It's the reason bullying is a critical issue in schools everywhere. It's the reason you've stopped reading comments on social media. The truth is, there are lots of people who are walking around angry. Somehow they grew up and missed a simple principle that is critical to life. Building a bridge is often more important than building a wall. It's often easier to build walls of anger instead of building bridges of peace. Getting along with each other, keeping the peace, requires us to set aside something or give something up for the sake of a lasting relationship. A relationship is most likely more important than whatever caused the anger in the first place. Simply put, peace costs you something. And the sooner we help kids understand this idea about peace, the better chance they will have at getting along with each other, even when the stakes are high. We define peace for kids like this: proving you care more about each other than winning an argument. And we define peace for adults the same way. Peace is hard. It often means taking the first step toward justice and reconciliation. It might involve giving away a right or a possession or maybe a little bit of your ego. But just think, what could happen if we taught kids to pursue peace in a way that honors God? Maybe it could start by helping everyone memorize what Paul said in Romans 14:19. And several of the kids already have this one memorized. So let us do all we can to live in peace, and let us work hard to build up one another. Let's think about that. Paul is encouraging us to do all we can to live in peace. He stresses how important it is for us to build a bridge, to fix what is broken between us and someone else. After all, this is what God did for us. Last week, we celebrated Easter, and that's when God went to great lengths to fix what was wrong between us and him. This month in kids' ministry, we are going to take a look in Genesis, where Abraham's son Isaac put peace into practice when he walked away from something that was rightfully his in order to keep the peace, and in doing so, was able to build a bridge and earn trust. We are also going to learn about Abigail in 1 Samuel, and we will find out how Abigail's peacemaking skills keeps her husband out of a lot of trouble. Peace is at the heart of God's character. We reflect God when we are working to build a bridge of peace in our relationships. Peace comes down to this: if God was willing to give his son so we can have peace with him, what are you willing to do? What bridges are you willing to build? How can you reconnect with others? Sometimes you have to know when to walk away. Sometimes you have to be willing to give up something. The point is, when you make peace, you help others know that they matter more than the argument, or know that they matter more than the things. Let's help kids grow up and learn to do whatever it takes to fix what's wrong between them and someone else. Let's help them learn how to make peace a priority in their life, because I'm sure that whatever the opposite of peace is terrible. And as always, if I'm up here, Professor Mobius must.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome back to the LaBerge and blah, blah, blah. I'll get to what we're doing down in the lab here in just a little bit. But first, I need your help with a very urgent personal matter. But I guess before I address that, I should address the elephant in the room. Now, that's a phrase that means that there's something so monumentally obvious that you can't ignore it, like having an elephant in your bedroom. And I'm sure you're thinking, Professor Mobius, why in the world would you need our help? You're so smart. Well, that is true, my dear children, but there are some things that even I cannot handle. And one of those things is relating to lab rats. Wait, no, that's not what they're called. What are they? Oh, yes, relating to other people. That's how you say it. I had a difficult situation happen this week. My bareheaded assistant, Wilford, and I were working on trying to calculate exactly how much of our universe is made from dark matter. Now, dark matter is very interesting stuff because you can't see it, taste it, smell it, hear it. It's just there, but you can't sense it. But it has an immense gravitational pull due to its mass, and it causes light to bend around it and moves the universe and the galaxies all over. It is really incredible stuff. But it's most of the universe, too. So we spent the whole day doing calculations and mathematical equations, and I came up with the number of 96.0000021 of the universe was made up of dark matter, where Wilford said that it was 96.0000022. Which is a number that's so astronomically ridiculous that it's absurd to even think that that would be the right one. So I told him that, and that started a two-hour argument on who was right, and kind of ended when I may have gone to name-calling and told him that he was nothing more than a doctor of education and educational leadership, which was a pretty low blow, and we haven't spoken to each other since. So, you know, at the time, I thought I was really clever, because he walked away, I won the argument. I thought I was so smart, until I started studying what we're learning down in the lab, which is all about peace, which is proving that you care more about others than winning an argument. So, you know, failed there. And then I read our scripture, which is, so let us do everything we can to live in peace, and let us work hard to build others up. Romans 14:19. So at that point, I realized I had done the complete opposite that God wanted me to do, and I was feeling pretty guilty. So since I didn't do the right thing then, I have to do the harder thing now, which is swallow my pride, admit that I did something wrong, and ask for forgiveness. But as you all know, I'm not very good at being a human. So I need your help. I went on the internet. I wanted to find the perfect apology letter. And as you all know, Wilfred put a microchip in my head months and months ago so he could read my thoughts and appear to me whenever he wants. So I created this scientific apparatus made from space-age technology called aluminum to block out all the mind waves so he can't read my thoughts, because I want to have the perfect apology before I speak to him. So after scouring the internet, I narrowed it down to 4 apology letters that I've come up with. And this is where I need your help, because you're going to have to help me narrow it down to the one I'll use on Wilfred. So I'm going to read these to you, and then we'll take a vote and see which one I should use. So here we go. Letter number 1. Employee number Wilfred. In regards to the recent unpleasant incident that happened on Thursday, April 8th, 2021, we would like to extend a formal apology for the argument that you started. We hope that this unfortunate event can be put behind us and our previous relationship can continue. Sincerely, Professor Mobius. I like that one. That's probably my favorite. Number 2. To whom it may concern. It has come to my attention that the position of best friend has opened up in your organization. I would like to reapply for this job and am available immediately. I have put together a small list of 5 qualifications showing that I am the best candidate for your company. Number 1, I own my own lab for science. Number 2, I already have a chip in my head that lets you read my thoughts. Number 3, I'm smart, handsome, and humble. Number 4, I can file and type up to 60 words a minute. Number 5, I am the one who found you in the first place during a sugar high and have been your previous best friend to this point. I have also included my resume and a list of references with this letter. Thank you for your time, Professor Mobius. Number 3, my dear friend Wilfred, I want to say how very sorry I am for the hurt that I caused you. It was extremely childish of me to act the way that I did. I hope that you can forgive me and that our friendship can continue, and it is worth more to me than all the dark matter in the universe. Your friend, Professor Mobius. And then my last letter, Wilfred, I'm sorry. Do you forgive me? Check box number 1 for yes and box number 2 for no. And then I didn't put a box next to number 2, so he has to pick number 1. Huh, I thought that was clever. So, who thinks that the first letter is the good one? Oh, I didn't see that one coming. Okay, how about number 2? Anyone? No? A couple? There's a couple. Good, too. How about number 3? Oh, wow. A lot of hands on that one. How about number 4? That one's simple and sweet. Oh, here's a couple. Oh, but I think number 3 wins. So I'll take your word for it. As the internet tells me, science is all about consensus. So whatever has the most votes is the thing that wins. So I will go ahead and type this up and get it to Wilfred and try to get our friendship back on track. In the meantime, make sure you don't make the same mistake I did. Don't focus so much on winning an argument that you totally forget about the other person's feelings. Instead, let us build bridges to others to bring them to Christ. I will see you all back here next month. Bye.
This morning, I have the honor to announce the winners of the Jackson Area Ministries Seed Collection Contest. So if we can get a little drum roll on your pew there. Okay. The winners are the people in the Appalachian counties of Southern Ohio who will have fruits and vegetables that will sustain them through the year. As a church, we collected 682 packets of seeds and $664, and I think that is something worth celebrating today. When added to the amount in our church budget that is designated already for this ministry, we were able to write them a check for nearly $1,000, and I have a feeling that will go a long ways in Southern Ohio. Kathy Toms delivered the seeds this week and the money, and I have no doubt that the people there were extremely grateful. I don't know about other Sunday school classes, but I know that our Sunday school class enjoyed getting involved and throwing in some friendly competition with other Sunday school classes. And I think the friendly competition may have increased our giving just a little bit. If you're involved in a Sunday school class or a small group, consider taking on another fun project now that this one is over. I know that in Andy's class, they collected, they did a whole Christmas for a family with five kids, and that's a great project. And I've heard of a lot of other projects that Sunday school classes take on just to make the world a better place. And if you're not in a Sunday school class or a small group, now might be a good time to check one out. If you come at 10 o'clock, this hallway back here is full. Every room is full with different Sunday school classes who are having a good time working together to learn more about Jesus. As things are beginning to open up just a little, allow yourself to open up a little bit too. When the seed collection began, Pastor Hazley did promise a special treat to the Sunday school class that came through with the greatest collection. And while I'm very sad to report that it was not our Sunday school class, I'm also surprised when I tell you it was not Gary Campbell's class. And so today we get to congratulate the Fig class, who came from third place in 1 week up to win the contest. They are this year's Jackson Area Ministry Seed Champions, and I do believe that Pastor Hazley treated them this morning to breakfast. So until next year, when we do this again, thank you again for all that you did, all that you donated, and just know that you made a big difference in the lives of people down in Southern Ohio.
So here in a minute, Pastor's going to be giving a sermon on the armor of God. And I decided this week I would do a special music, and the song that I chose falls right in line with that, and the song is called Defender.
You go before I know that you've even gone to win my war. You come back with the head of my enemy. You come back and you call it my victory. You go before I know. You've even gone to win my war. Your love becomes my greatest defense. Leads me from the dry wilderness. And all I did was praise. All I did was worship. Was bow down. All I did was stay still. And hallelujah, you have saved me. So much better your way. Much better your way.
You know before I do where my heart can seek to find your truth. This is the shade I'm living in. And you restore my faith and hope again. All I did was pray. All I did was worship. All I did was bow down. All I did was stay still. And hallelujah, you have saved me. So much better your way. And hallelujah, great defender, so much better your way. When I thought I lost me, you knew where I left me. You reintroduced me to your love. You picked up all my pieces, put me back together. You are the defender of my heart. When I thought I lost me, you knew where I left me. You reintroduced me to your love. You picked up all my pieces, put me back together. You are the defender of my heart. All I did was praise. All I'll do is worship. Lord, I'll just bow down. And I'm just gonna stay still.
That couldn't be any simpler. All I did was praise. All I did was worship. Bow down and be still. I think that was a great message. So the Bible reading today is from, both are from the New Testament. And I am going to be reading from the Good News Translation. So here's the first one. Comes from Ephesians 6, 16. Here we go. At all times, carry faith as a shield, for with it you will be able to put out all the burning arrows shot by the evil one. Sounds pretty straightforward, Richard. I imagine you're going to clarify that for us today, aren't you? And the second one, also in the New Testament, 1 Peter 1, 3 through 5, again, the Good News Translation. Let us give thanks to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Because of his great mercy, he gave us new life by raising Jesus Christ from death. This fills us with a living hope, and so we look forward to possessing the rich blessings that God keeps for his people. He keeps them for you in heaven, where they cannot decay or spoil or fade away. They are for you, who through faith are kept safe by God's power for the salvation which is ready to be revealed at the end of time. And God will give us understanding to the reading of his word. Amen?
Thank you. Thank you, Patty. And happy birthday. I can give another little additional plug for our prayer time tonight. I'd encourage you to come out. We're emphasizing family, loved ones tonight. And we're not just to sit back and kind of accept things and let things happen as our loved ones may be struggling. No, we're called to pray for them. So while the prayer time is open for all subjects, there will be an emphasis tonight on praying for our family and loved ones. I hope you can come out tonight. Well, Professor Mobius was talking about apologies and what is an appropriate apology and what is not. I'd like to give you an example of something that's not, in my estimation, an appropriate apology, okay? There is actually a company, they have been bought out, but they're still in existence. And the company is called Second Chance Body Armor. Second Chance Body Armor. They were a big supplier of police departments, body armor for police departments. They were the first ones to make available Kevlar body armor. But in a short period of time after that was introduced, a number of police wearing their body armor were killed in shootings. It turned out there was some kind of a defect in the armor, a defect in the way they had manufactured it and the design of it, and it ended up costing a number of police their lives. An investigation was launched. It was determined there was a defect. And here's what the body armor company did. They offered an apology to anyone their defective body armor had inconvenienced. Inconvenienced. It had resulted in the death of a number of police officers. Body armor is one of those things that's vital. If it does not work, it is not inconvenient, it's deadly. And the body armor that God offers the Christian, it will not be inconvenient if it doesn't work. It will be deadly. But of course, what God offers is never defective. It always does the job if we use it correctly. I was watching a TV program recently, and a policewoman was shot, and she was knocked to the ground, and her fellow officers ran to her thinking that she was wounded badly or even dead. But because she wore body armor, it bruised her, but it did not really harm her. The shield, the armor, if you will, it took the brunt of the blow. Well, let's think a little bit about the person who wrote those words in Ephesians, who outlined the armor of God. The man who wrote that, who wrote about the shield of faith, is a man who was beaten. He was imprisoned. He wrote of his personal disappointments. He'd been shipwrecked. I mean, if you sat down and wrote a list of bad things that could happen to you back then, the Apostle Paul, perhaps more than any other person living then, he checked all the boxes. He had more seemingly bad things happen to him than anyone else. And he's writing the book of Ephesians. He's writing it from a Roman jail. So it really doesn't sound like his shield of faith is shielding him from much. But his shield of faith did not shield him from the things that you and I want shielded from. But what he is not saying, he's not saying that the Christian will never have bad circumstances. His life shows that that's not possible. But he's praying that the circumstances won't cause him to be separated or distant from God. With eyes of faith, from a prison cell, instead of seeing an impossible situation, Paul sees things from God's perspective, not Satan's. So confidence in the Lord rather than despair marked his perspective. Now there's a belief among some, including Christians, that Jesus did this amazing work we celebrated on Easter. We had the victory. He won the victory over death. The promise of the resurrection has been realized. And we absolutely marvel, as we should, at what he did. And then we picture him rising from the dead, saying a few things to his disciples in the days after his resurrection. And then he goes off to heaven after basically accomplishing that great work. And he leaves us kind of to fend for ourselves. And basically the only resource we have as Christians to live a victorious Christian life is the memory of what he did. Now we are to remember what he did. But a memory is not to be the basis of our Christian life. A memory by itself can't sustain us. No, he has done much more than leave us with a memory of himself. He has equipped us. He has equipped us in this life to triumph. Yes, he wants us to triumph. Yes, he has made it possible for us to triumph. But we often fail to fully use the tools that he has given us. Have you ever tried to unscrew a nut from a bolt and the nut is screwed tight on the bolt? And you can try, but you will not be able to unscrew it using just your fingers. That's just not going to work. You need a wrench. It would be silly to insist using your fingers to unscrew that nut when there's a wrench right beside you. But that's what Christians do when we fail to use the tools that God has given us. It's silly. It's not going to work. And we need to access and utilize the tools that God has given us. Now, last week we talked about the reaction of those who heard about Jesus' resurrection. And at first they struggled, and we mentioned Thomas and how he struggled. He was not there. He was not present with the other disciples when Jesus first appeared among them. And he came right out and said to them after seeing them later, until I can see for myself, till I can touch his wounds, I'm not going to believe. Well, a lesser known fact about Thomas is that he's called Didymus. And Didymus means twin. Thomas was a twin. Now, his twin is not alluded to in any other scripture, but I have an idea who Thomas's twin might be. I think his twin might be you and me. Because like Thomas, we wrestle with our own doubts. Doubts about God's goodness, or that he really cares about us. Or we experience doubts because of some hardship in our lives. Pain can often lead to doubt. Jesus' death had traumatized Thomas and caused him to kind of shut his heart down. When we're hurt, when we doubt, we can forget that God is our true shield. When I just described to you struggling with doubts and wrestling with difficult things in life, what that is spiritual warfare. The devil is not on God's level, but he is crafty, and he leverages our hurts and hardships to his advantage. When bad things happen, Satan uses those things to introduce doubt into our lives. For instance, he'll whisper. You've all heard this whisper probably. If God really loved you, he wouldn't have allowed this, or he wouldn't be allowing this to happen to you. You're at the bottom of God's priority list. You might as well give up. Those kinds of suggestions are what the Bible calls the flaming darts of the evil one. In Bible times, flaming arrows were common. Those arrows were dipped in pitch and they were lit. And so they were very dangerous. Not only could they penetrate what they hit, but they could also spread fire among soldiers. Sometimes the arrows were fired directly at the soldiers, sometimes at the ground around the soldiers, to start a fire. If that were the case, the soldiers would be distracted from their main objective, which was winning a battle, and they'd be running around trying to stamp out a fire or try not to get burned up themselves. A fire like that can spread and damage the whole unit. And that's one reason why we have to be careful with how we handle the fiery darts of the devil. If we start complaining about God, that attitude can affect others like a spreading fire and do damage. Also, hundreds or even thousands of flaming arrows could be launched at the same time, making it seem literally as if fire were falling from the sky. When difficulty hits, Satan grabs one of his fiery arrows and shoots it at us. He tries to ignite fear and doubt. He tries to inspire fear and doubt within us. He tries to get us to be separated from God. So how are we to deal with these things when they happen? How are we to deal with these fiery darts? God gives us the shield of faith. The scripture said, in all circumstances, take up the shield of faith. In all circumstances, to extinguish all the darts that the devil shoots at us. Many of the soldiers' shields back then, they were designed specifically to combat fiery darts. Many were lined with leather and soaked in water right before battle. God similarly protects us in every way we need it. Whatever our need is, God will come to us and provide what we need. When doubts creep in, as with Thomas, he comes to us and he's our shield and he protects us. Doubts are natural. People should not be condemned for doubts, especially in the midst, of difficult circumstance. People need space and time to process things. But thank God, God does not judge us on the firmness of our faith, because if he did, we might score well one day and bad the next day. Remember, Jesus said, faith even as small as the grain of a mustard seed is enough for God to accomplish his work through us. Even faith equal to a grain of mustard seed is enough for God to accomplish his work in us. The shield of faith is not effective because of our faith. It is effective because of the object of our faith. The object of our faith is God himself. As children, we've all done this. I'm sure I did it. When you're a small child, you may be in with a group. Something happens. And what do you do as a small child if your parents are close? You run to your parents. And you can even hide behind your parents. Because you know that they will protect you. You know they won't let anything bad happen to you. You see, that's what we're to do with God. When the fiery darts of Satan are shot at us, we are to turn and run to God. That's a big part of our shield of faith. That's the biggest part of our shield of faith, is turning and running to God. Satan has a two-pronged strategy. Not only does he fire the arrows, but he tries to distract us and convince us you don't need to run to God. You can rely on your own resources. And the upshot of that is, no pun intended, the upshot of that is we're going to run out of our own strength and we're not going to be able to stand under the assaults of the devil if we do not run to God. Our shield is God. We must run to God. I want you to listen to these scripture. From Genesis 15:1, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. Remember Abram, all that he went through. Remember that he left everything that he knew at God's command. I mean, he went through a lot. And here's what God said. Fear not, Abram. I am your shield. Your reward shall be very great. Excuse me. Happy are you, from Deuteronomy. Happy are you, O Israel. Who is like you? A people saved by the Lord, the shield of your help. From 2 Samuel, the Lord is my rock and my fortress, my deliverer, my God, my rock in whom I take refuge, my shield and the horn of my salvation. We still need a rock. We still need a fortress. We still need a deliverer. We still need a refuge. We still need a shield. Bad things had happened. Bad things still happen. But the shield shielded those folks who wrote those words from being outside God's purpose. It kept them on course. It provided stability in the storm as long as they used that shield as God intended. When we think of the shield of faith, we want the shield to make us comfortable. I want to hold this shield out in front of me. And so by that, I have this amazing resource that's going to keep me from any pain, any hardship, any discomfort. That's not true. That's not the purpose of the shield. The shield of faith that Paul is talking about keeps circumstances from harming our relationship with the Lord. I've seen people in all kinds of circumstances who are going through difficult times. But their countenance is peaceful, their heart is full because of the shield of faith.
And I've seen others going through literally the same thing. And they have not turned to the Lord. They did not pick up their shield of faith. And the devil has hit them and hit them hard. And they have turned into defeated people. You see, from the outside looking in, honestly, Paul failed. Paul was a failure. I mean, stop and think about it. Who would listen to someone who's writing about God protecting them, God shielding them when he's writing it from prison? Who would listen to someone like that? But yet, Paul knew what he was talking about. He knew what he was talking about because he knew he was right in the center of God's will. And that's what the shield of faith provides. It provides us certainty. It provides us stability. It provides us that assurance that we are not separated from God and that we haven't short-circuited God's plans for our lives. The Christian who utilizes the shield of faith has such a powerful, powerful advantage. A couple of days ago, I was thinking about the sermon, and a pop song I haven't thought of for years and years and years popped into my mind. It was from a time when I was in junior high school, about 10 years ago, okay? You may remember this, and I'm not going to sing it for you. It's called, When Will I Be Loved? When Will I Be Loved? Remember that? And in the song, Linda Ronstadt goes through the song. She goes through the bad things that have happened to her. I've been cheated. I've been mistreated. I've been put down. I've been pushed around. I've been blue, been lied to. But that's not really the focus of the song. What she really wants to know is when she will be loved. The Christian is not shielded by the shield of faith from all bad things. But we know we are loved. We know we are loved. And that is the most important thing. We know that our Savior is with us. We know our Savior is in control. We know that whatever is happening to us has not derailed our relationship. We know that He is right there for us. Yes, bad things will happen sometimes, seemingly bad things to Christians, yes. But those bad things need not harm our relationship with the Lord, but drive us closer to Him. That's how, when we are weak, we are made strong. As we utilize the shield of faith we've been given, the soldiers had that shield, but they were still in battle. Conclusion of the first service, we sang Victory in Jesus. And we do. We are promised. That is a promise from God. We are promised victory in Jesus. But to attain, you know, we see that those words, victory in Jesus. And instantly we think, yes, that is what I want. I want the victory. I want the victory in Jesus. If you want the victory in Jesus, what that presupposes is this. There's going to be a battle. To have victory, there must be a battle. And in this Christian life, in this world, we will have our battles. Let us not deceive ourselves and think that the shield of faith keeps us from battles. It does not. But what the shield of faith that God has provided does promise is that we will be victorious in Him. Jesus is stronger than the one who attacks your faith. Christ is stronger than whatever can happen to you. Christ is stronger than that bad medical report you may get. Christ is stronger than your family, which is not all that you would hope it would be. Christ is stronger than whatever may be going on or will be going on in your life. He is stronger. He is your indestructible shield. But we have to pick the shield up. We have to utilize the tools that God has given us, the protection that God has given us, because that is more than enough to enable us to go through life safely. You already have, you already are, or you will go through times in your life where it is evident that you have to have the shield of faith. I say to you, church, stand strong. Stand strong in the Lord and what He has provided for you. And God will see you through. God will never lead you into anything that He is not capable of leading you through and out of. Indeed, God will never lead you into anything but what He will not lead you through and out of. Why? Because He is greater. He is greater and He will see you through. And so I am not here today to say accept Christ or recommit to Christ and all your troubles will go away. I'm not here to say that. That would be a lie. But what I am here to say is this. Commit your way to the Lord. Pick up the shield of faith and He will see you through. He promises in this life not to make us comfortable, not to give us an easy life, but to give us a victorious life. Today the altar is open and the invitation is given for you to put on your shield of faith. And perhaps you are going through some struggle right now and you just can't even see your way forward. The way seems so dark and cloudy, and you just don't know what's going to happen. I say to you, trust God, put on your shield of faith, and at the right season, when God is ready, He will lead you through victorious. Oh, please do not leave this church today not having put on that shield. Please put it on. Let Him strengthen you. And in the act of strengthening you, you will be an inspiration to others. And your Christian life will have an impact. Altar's open. The invitation is given today to come, to trust, and to put on your shield of faith.
Let's stand together.
You are here. Moving in our midst, I worship You, I worship You.
You are here, working in this place, I worship You, I worship You. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keep, light in the darkness, my God, that is who You are.
Oh, You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keep, light in the darkness, my God, that is who You are. You are here, touching every heart. I worship You, I worship You. You are here, healing every heart. I worship You, I worship You. You are here, turning lives around. I worship You, worship You. You are here, commanding every heart. I worship You, I worship You. Oh, 'cause You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who You are. Oh, You are miracle worker, promise keep, light in the darkness, my God, that is who You are. 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 Even when I don't see it, You're working. Even when I don't feel it, You're working. You never stop, never stop working. Never stop, You never stop working.
He Even when I don't feel it, you're working. Never stop working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, never stop working. You never stop, 'cause you are the way maker, the miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. The way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. God, that is who you are. Oh, that is who you are. 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 That is who you are.
Church, God has given you the victory. He has given you the victory in whatever you are or whatever will face. He has given you the victory. He has not given you an absence of battlegrounds, but He has given you the victory in those battlegrounds. And for that we say, thank you, Jesus. Thank you for the shield of faith for which you, with which you have equipped us. May we put it on. May we utilize it. And may with that shield of faith we go out and live the lives you have called us to live for the glory of your name's sake. And so as we go now, we go fully equipped to do everything that God wants from us. Oh, we thank you. We give you praise. In Jesus' name, amen.
Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, never stop working. Never stop. Oh, even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, never stop working. You never stop. 'Cause you are the way maker, the miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is. And you are the way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who.